You might have seen some of my other Home Assistant power flow card videos. I seem to be making this a bit of a thing now, so what those other cards all did was take a lot of power data and attempt to display it in a nice, clear way so as it's obvious what's happening. But what if instead of the clean look you wanted something a lot busier? Well, that's what the Sunsynk power flow card is all about. First of all, I want to say thank you to Michael for pointing this card out to me, and to Greg for helping me test the configuration. This card is basically suitable for hybrid inverters. That's where you have a single inverter that deals with both your solar panels and your battery. If you've got an AC coupled system, then this probably won't work well for you. You can bodge it to work using template sensors, but I'm not going to cover that in this video. So this is the card itself in action, with a lot of simulated data in it. There are two modes, a light mode which shows quite a bit of detail, and a full mode which goes full on bonkers with data. This card is designed to emulate the system power flow diagram that is shown on the LCD displays of Sunsynk hybrid inverters. It's clearly aimed at Sunsynk customers because of all the various entity names corresponding with entities created by the Sunsynk integration. But if you stick around until later in the video, I'll show you an example of how you can configure this to work with a GivEnergy hybrid inverter. So installation of this card is via hacks. Go and check out my how to install hacks video if you don't know how to do that. Once you've got hacks installed, you'll need to go to the hacks interface to the front end section, and then these three little dots in the top right hand corner. Go down to custom repositories and you'll need to paste in the URL of the repository. I'll put that in the description for you. And in the category, you choose Lovelace and click on add. It should appear in the list here like this. So we just close that down and a new repository has been found, so we select that and we click on the download button and the other download button and give that a few seconds, and now we need to reload our browser. Now to put the card on the dashboard. The hardest part of this whole process is going to be working out which sensors are mandatory or not and which ones you need to get this working. So I'm going to start by showing you a minimal configuration and then we'll add on some extra fancy features. I've created a whole bunch of simulated sensors, but as long as your inverter's integration gives you the right types of entities, then you can just use those instead. One of the great things about this card is that if you just don't have a suitable entity available for something that is specified as required by the card, you can just use the value of none and it'll carry on and ignore it. Here are my simulated sensors, and I've created a new dashboard just for this card. I'm going to edit this dashboard and I'm going to add a new card. And if I go down to the bottom, you see custom Sunsynk Powerflow card, so select that. Now I've already created a basic configuration here, so if I go to this document, I'm going to copy that to the clipboard. We'll go back here, I'm going to replace all of this text with my simulated sensors. And it takes a couple of seconds for the diagram to refresh. There you go, you see it's working now. Just to go through the main options here, now I need to point out up at the top here, you see where it says energy, you need to fill that in manually to correspond to the amount of battery capacity you've got. So let's say you've got an 8.2 kilowatt hour battery, you would change that to 8,200. And if your battery stopped at 4%, then you set that to 4%. If it's set to 10%, you'd set that to 10. And let's look at some of the entities we've got down here. So all of the entities I've got here are pretty much mandatory except for the PV ones down at the bottom. So you have to fill in your inverter grid voltage, but you can just put the word none. See, I don't have a frequency value, so I just put the word none in there. You have to put in how much power your inverter is sending out, which is this one here, and also you can put the current in if you've got that as well, or just put none. Grid status is quite a good one. If you've got a binary sensor that tells you whether your grid is disconnected or not, so is there a power cut, then you can put that here. Input boolean sim grid connected. I can disconnect the grid and you should see it's got a big red cross through it, so that is quite a cool feature, I think. You can also put in your battery sock level, so it's at 86% right now. I'm gonna tweak that there so I can say it's actually at 64, and you can see it adjusts that, and it tells you how long it is until the battery would be charged if it was charging. But right now you can see the simulated sensors are saying it's discharging. You've got sensors to say how much you've imported or exported from the grid so far today, and obviously how much load has been consumed today. So that's 30.4 kilowatt hours according to my sim sensors. And then you've also got your solar array down here. Now this supports, I think, up to 4 solar arrays, but if I go and get a bit of config I've got here, you can see how it's got one solar array feeding into the inverter here. If I go and grab a bit of extra config here, that's that bit I've got there, and I paste that in at the end, you can see I now need to change this to 2, and we've now got 2 solar arrays feeding into the inverter. And you can also add extra things off the house, like a hot water heater or an EV charger. So let me show you here. I've got this bit of config and I put that under load, and that should give me an extra icon there. Yep, but that is no good on its own because I need to actually tell it which sensor is providing the power. So I just go down and add an extra one under here, and in a second or two it should update, but I need to tell it to use a little bit of power. So let's say it's 1700 watts. There you go, you can see 1700 watts being used by the EV charger. So you can see that this card can be crazy busy and quite complicated to set up, especially working out which entities are needed. If you have a GivEnergy hybrid inverter, then I figured out which GivTCP entities you need to use. You'll need GivTCP running first, so go and check out my latest GivTCP video for instructions on how to do that. I'll put a link in the description to that, of course. Now, I don't have a hybrid inverter myself, so I needed a bit of help, and luckily Greg from the GivTCP Facebook group was very cooperative. It took a bit of trial and error, but we think we've got there in the end. I'll put a link to my website in the description too, and on there you'll find some configuration that you can copy and paste. This is the configuration then. What you need to do is make sure that the X's here are replaced with the actual inverter serial number that you've got. It might be a good idea to go and check your GivTCP entities are in the same format. They should be by default, but some people like to fiddle and change the defaults. Don't forget to change the battery capacity too. This configuration will actually produce a very minimal working card. I've only included one solar array, as you can see here, but you can add a second one too if you like, and you can add an EV charger or other monitored load too, just like I demoed earlier on in the video. I haven't included the battery voltages in this card, but GivTCP also provides that data if you want to add it in too. I'm just trying to keep things simple here. There we go, another power flow card. I think for hybrid inverter owners, this particular card would look quite good on a wall-mounted dashboard or something similar. If you do make use of this, then please let me know in the comments. I always like to hear how these sort of things are being used in the real world. Anyway, please give the video a like and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.